This is a Faith FM podcast. You're listening to The Faith Experiment with Robbie Bergen, right across Australia, right here on Faith FM.
Hello there, and thanks for joining me once again. I'm Robbie Bergen, and you are listening to The Faith Experiment. This is episode number 56, and I'm calling this episode The Science of Focus. Now, on this episode, I have got a very, very special free offer for you. It is an amazing little book that I personally have put together for you for today's episode. So you will want to stick around to the end of the episode to get today's code word to claim your free copy of what I'm calling Your Journey Through the Bible in 365 Days. You want to know more? Stick around. I'll explain what this amazing free giveaway is all about. But right now, the only thing you need to focus on is getting today's show number saved into your phone. The number for this episode is 0488-45311. That's 0488-45311. Save it into your phone, call it The Faith Experiment, and as you stay listening to the show, you will get code words, you will get the opportunity to text in your thoughts and your questions. But stick around for today's great giveaway, Your Journey Through the Bible in 365 Days. Save the number on your phone, 0488-45311, and wait for today's code word. Now, it is a new year, at least when I am airing this episode. It is a brand new year. It is 2024. So much has happened over the end of 2023 and the beginning of 2024. And I hope that you are well, you are safe, and you are experimenting with your faith. Now, if you are joining me for the first time here on The Faith Experiment, this show, this podcast is all about putting faith into practice. And over the last couple of years, I have, I started the episode sharing my faith experiment, how I became a faith experimenter, how I went from a non-believer and became a follower of these ancient manuscripts, and ultimately its author, who I believe is Jesus Christ. So if you have been around for the journey over the last 3 years, you would know that I have covered my story in great detail. You have looked at some of the questions that I get asked for time from time to time on biblical themes. You would have gone through a series on how I study the Bible. Well, on this episode, because we are starting a new year, and it's a good episode for any time of year in case you're listening to this a couple of years later or a couple of weeks later or months or days. But if you're listening to this right now, the beginning of January 2024, it is a good time to think about focus. What is your focus on? Where is your focus? And so I'm calling this episode The Science of Focus. And I want to help you on this episode to put your life into perspective and examine the faith principles from these ancient manuscripts that we call the Old and New Testament of the Bible. And we want to see what the Bible has to say about our focus and our priorities. And, you know, this is the time of year that a lot of people think about New Year's resolutions and how they want to improve their lives and change their lives, and that there's this psychological reset that takes place over the end of 1 year and the start of a new year. I'm not going to talk much about resolutions and those sorts of things. What I want to talk about is focus. What are we focusing on? How do we choose to focus on the things that are good? And that is the basis of what we're going to be covering on this episode. Now, if you have missed any of the previous episodes of The Faith Experiment and you want to catch up on some of the details that I've covered, you want to get the Faith FM app on your phone from your app store, or go to faithfm.com.au, look under the podcasting section for The Faith Experiment, or you can find The Faith Experiment on all good podcasting platforms, allowing you to stay up to date with all the great episodes that we're covering on this series. Now, if you are listening to The Faith Experiment on Apple Podcast or Google Podcast or Spotify, one of these platforms, please do me a favor and review the show. give us some stars or some thumbs up, depending on what your platform does, and you know, help the algorithm out to get the Faith Experiment out further and wider. And also, if you could do me a favor and tell two of your friends or family about the Faith Experiment and get them listening too, and help share the love and build the Faith Experimenting audience. So let's get started. Episode 56, The Science of Focus. There is a very famous photograph called the Pale Blue Dot. Now, if you've never seen this photo, you want to go out and Google it so you can see what I'm talking about. It's called the Pale Blue Dot. It was a photograph taken by the Voyager 1 spacecraft on February 14, 1990. And the story goes that this Voyager spacecraft was sent out on a mission in the 70s, I think it was launched. And its goal was to explore basically deep space. February 14, 1990, hits the 6 billion kilometer mark away from the sun, and the famous Carl Sagan, who is a astronomer, he asks the project team who are sort of overseeing the mission, he says, can you please turn around Voyager and take one last photo of Earth from 6 billion kilometers away? And the picture, the pale blue dot, is the result. Now, I'm going to describe the picture to you. It's probably better if you, you know, pull out your phone and Google the pale blue dot. But anyway, here's what it sort of looks like looking at it right now. It's kind of like a gradient from black sort of to a light whitey purple color. And there is from top to bottom. And then there are three sort of almost diagonal sort of light beams or sunbeams going from the top to the bottom of the picture. And in one of them, about a third of the way down from the top, there is a tiny blue dot. Like literally if you're looking on a phone or a screen, it's the size of a pixel. It's very, very, very small. And that little pale blue dot or pixel in the photograph is Earth. And it's pretty impressive when you look at the picture, when you think that that little dot, that's home. And that's what Carl Sagan is famously noted for saying when he saw this picture for the first time. He said, look again at that dot. It's literally a pixel. That's here, referring to Earth. That's home, he wrote. That's us. On that pixel, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you have ever heard of, every human being who has ever been has lived out their lives on that little pixel, that little pale blue dot. And when I first came across this picture a number of years ago, the thing that it did for me is it helped me put things into perspective. It helped me focus on things in a better way. You see, this perspective of viewing Earth from 6 billion kilometers, shows how small our place actually is in the vastness of the universe. And that can have a profound impact on the way that we view our world, view our lives. Now, the chances of you ever, you know, visiting a Voyager spacecraft or a Starship from SpaceX or one of these, what is it, Atomos rockets that they're building for NASA, chances of us being one of those passengers is pretty slim. But look, I'm sure you can identify with flying on a plane. You know, I do a lot of travel in this role. And I often sit on the plane and I love looking out the window at just the smallness of humanity on the face of the Earth. And, you know, that's only from, you know, I think here in Australia, we probably get to around about 20,000, 25,000 feet. Internationally, you get about 30,000 feet. It's not that high compared to, you know, going on a rocket or on one of these Voyager spacecraft. But it still gives you the perspective, right? The size of your house, for example, when you look out the plane window, it's pretty hard to see it. And yet in that house, from the window of the plane, is everything you've ever collected, everything you've ever saved up money for, every sale that your wife has gone on and purchased, you know, the rug, the curtains, the forks, the china, whatever it is, every tool you have in your garage, your ride-on mower, if you're on a farm, your tractor, every single thing you have ever wanted in life and pursued and acquired is under that little roof that you're seeing out of your plane window in the vastness of what is Australia. Equally, at 6 billion kilometers away from Earth, everything, geopolitics, the Labor Party, the Liberal Party, the Greens, the Independents, the NRL, the AFL, soccer, the war in Ukraine, the war in Israel, all of these things are on the size of a pixel from 6 billion kilometers away. Just by simply changing your perspective, whether it's from Voyager at 6 billion kilometers away, or whether it's from, you know, the seat of a Boeing 737 flying from Brisbane to Melbourne, our focus shifts when our perspective changes. Our small place in the vastness of our state, our country, or even our planet can have a profound impact on the way we view our world and our lives. It forces us to ask the question, what is truly important in life? And how do we prioritize our time, our energy, and our resources? You know, the other day, a couple of weeks ago now, I was in Brisbane visiting some friends, and I had a bit of a scare. I'm all right, and there's nothing wrong with me, but it was a bit of a scare. And it caused me to think and to put my life into perspective. The scare that I had was I got all of a sudden dizzy while I was driving, and I told my wife she had to take over from me. I got out of the car. I walked around the car to hop in the passenger side, and I almost passed out. When we got home, I checked my blood pressure. My blood pressure was really, really low, and so we went to ER. They ran some tests. They had me there for 8 hours. And, you know, for a while there, I mean, 8 hours sitting in ER wondering what's happening. The fear was my heart, and turns out my heart's fine, but the fear then was my heart. And when you're sitting there in an ER from 8 o'clock in the evening to about 3 or 4 in the morning, and you're not sure whether your heart has a real problem or not, you start to think differently about what's important. Is work important? Are the flights important? Are people important? Are your goals important? Your children important? Your spouse, your relationship? It starts changing things, and you start to think, if I've only got a few minutes left, what's the most important thing to me right now? Now, thankfully for me, everything seemed to be okay and it all turned out all right. But what about you? Where's your focus? Do you have a focus? Do you have a perspective? Well, that's what we're going to explore after the break. We're going to come back and we're going to start delving into this biblical and scientific principle of focus. Now, you want to stick around after the break. I'm going to give you a code word to get today's great free offer called The Journey Through the Bible in 365 Days. But right now, we're going to take a short break, and we're going to be listening to a song, one of my favorite artists, Zach Williams, Rescue Story.
You're listening to The Faith Experiment with Robbie Bergen, right across Australia, right here on Faith FM. Connect with us via text message on 0488 453 11. That's 0488 453 11. Or send an email to robbie@faithfm.com.au.
there I was, empty-handed, crying out from the pit of my despair. There you were in the shadows, holding out your hand, you met me there. And now where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story, lifted me up from the ashes, carried my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You were my rescue story. You are, you are my rescue story. You are, you are. You write in the pages before I had a name, before I needed grace. Time I ran away, you were louder than my shame. And now where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story, lifting from the ashes, carrying my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You were my rescue story. You never gave up on me. You never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Oh, 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 you never gave up on me. Never gave up on me. You're my testimony. Oh, 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 you never gave up on me. Oh, you never gave up on me. This is my testimony.
To the Faith Experiment with Robbie Bergen, right across Australia, right here on Faith FM.
Welcome back to the Faith Experiment. That was Zach Williams with Rescue Story, and this is episode 56 of the Faith Experiment, and I'm calling this episode The Science of Focus. Before the break, I was sharing with you this photograph called the Pale Blue Dot, which was taken by the Voyager 1 spacecraft February 14, 1990, about 6 billion kilometers away from the sun. And it basically shows Earth as the size of a pixel. And that's hence why it's called the pale blue dot. And as I shared before the break, the famous astronomer Carl Sagan writes that that little blue dot, that's our home. Everything you've ever loved, everyone you've ever loved, everyone you've ever known, anyone you've ever heard of, every human being who ever was lived out their life on that little dot, pale blue dot. And I like how he puts it, pale blue dot, suspended in a sunbeam. Now, as I was sharing before the break, when you shift your perspective, your focus changes, obviously. and the perspective of seeing everything you have and are and have experienced at a vastness like the 6 billion kilometers, or whether it's on the plane looking down at your roof from 37,000 feet, it puts things in perspective. It helps us to question what's truly important in life. How do we prioritize our time, our energy, and our resources? Now, on this episode, what I want to do is I want to take you through a couple of biblical principles that I think will help you put things into focus this year. There's a Bible text from the book of Psalms. Now, Psalms is an interesting book. It's a collection of, they're essentially poems that were sung. So kind of like hymns, I guess. And most of them are written by David, the famous king from Israel. And they describe his relationship with God, with his enemies, with those that he loved. And it's a very emotional book. I never really liked Psalms when I first became a faith experimenter. But over the years, I've come to really appreciate the richness and the depth that David brings in many of these Psalms. This is Psalm 8, verse 3 and 4. He says, "When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have ordained." He says this, "What is man that you're mindful of him, and the son of man that you visit him?" So David's putting this idea that when he looks up at the heavens and the work of his fingers, the moon and the stars and all those sorts of things, he says, how do you even have time to consider us? We're so insignificant. We're so small, and yet you visit us. Here's a similar thought from the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verse 8 and 9. It says, "For my thoughts," this is God speaking, "for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." So even God recognizes that we're quite small in comparison to himself, right? So you have David's perspective looking up, and now you have God's perspective looking down. And these perspectives help us have the right focus. So let me share with you one of the key factors that plays a role in shaping our perceptions and our experiences of the world in which we live in, which also impacts greatly what we focus on. I want to talk to you about the reticular activating system, or the RAS system. The reticular activating system is a small part of the brain. It's no one part or thing. It's a bunch of things working together, hence the word system. And it determines what you pay attention to and what you don't pay attention to, or what you ignore. So the reticular activating system has the ability to filter out distraction and help you focus on what you value as important. So the reticular activating system has several functions. It controls sleep and waking up and attention. It has a very, very sophisticated filter, and it creates blind spots, intentional blind spots to what you should consider to be junk. And it acts like sort of an executive assistant by telling us what's important and what's not. It also allows us to focus on what we value, and it allows us to perceive threats, and it supports us when we set goals. So like I said before, it's not one point of the brain, it's like a system working within the brain, acting as your very own personal assistant. Now, you might be saying, "Robbie, what are you talking about? I thought this was a show about faith and experimenting and archaeology and the ancient manuscripts and all that good stuff, making it practical." Well, let me assure you, this is a very, very practical episode. Let me give you a story to illustrate how the reticular activating system works, and I'm sure you can identify with this. So over Christmas and New Year's, my wife and I, my 8-year-old son and my 2-year-old daughter, we decided to do a 4,800-kilometer road trip. It was a very long time driving, but I digress. So on the road trip, we spent some time with some friends of ours, and our friends have four children. So there's six in the family. And as you can appreciate, once you get to six people in a family, you need a different kind of car. Let's call it a minivan. Well, our friends showed us their car and how much storage they had and all the fancy things that the seats can do, lay flat, go up, back, forward, all that stuff. And, you know, it was a nice looking, you know, bus. But anyway, the funny thing is that for the rest of the trip, which was pretty much halfway, so we did about 2,400 Ks back after visiting our friends, it was bizarre. Every second car that we passed on the road was the exact same car that our friends had just showed us. But the bizarre thing was, is that we had never noticed that car anywhere in Australia on all the roads before our friends showed us the car. Now, what had happened is our reticular activating system was trained on some new information. Let me give you another example. Have you ever bought a t-shirt or a dress or skirt, whatever it is that you bought, some clothing? And as soon as you buy it, now you see everyone is wearing it. Or you buy your own new car and you go to the car park and now all you can see is the same model, the same color as your new car. Well, if you've ever experienced something like this, where you've never seen or noticed something before until you got one, then you see it everywhere, that is because you have trained the reticular activating system. Because basically what's happening is your system has been trained to focus on that particular thing. And the RSA, the reticular activating system, it filters out distractions that helps you focus on what is important to you now. So before you bought the Tesla or the Camry or whatever it is that you're driving, before you bought that, that car wasn't important to you. But now that you've bought it, now it's important to you, and your RSA is constantly filtering out all the other cars and helping you only get information on when that car that's important to you now bubbles up through the layers of the subconscious and alerts you. It's a fascinating system, and you know, we could spend a whole episode just talking about the system. Not really the point of the episode, but it's an important foundation to understand the science behind focus. So another example is those things that show up on social media. You know, those things that says, only people with IQs that are super high can solve this problem in 3 seconds. And it'll be like a page full of the number eight, like, you know, 10 rows of eights with, you know, 58 in each row or something. And then there's like 1 6 somewhere in the whole maze. And you're supposed to spot the six outside of all the eights. Well, it's that kind of principle that illustrates the RSA at work. Because what you've just done by reading the instructions is, I only care about the six, not the eights. And so the I information that's coming through just gets eliminated by the RSA as noise. And once the six is seen, you get alerted through your subconscious up to your elevated conscious. So the RSA is an amazing biological tool that we have at our disposal to train to help us focus on things that are important to us and to ignore the things that we really don't need to worry about. So after the break, what we're going to talk about is how can we help take advantage of the reticular activating system using biblical principles to help shift our perspective so that we are focusing on the things that are truly important. So stick around for the code word to come up after the break to get this great new book, Your Journey Through the Bible in 365 Days. Now, here is another favorite of mine, Zach Williams, once again, with To the Table. I'll be right back after this on The Faith Experiment.
Hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you. And a friend who understands everything you're going through. keep standing at a distance in the shadow of your shame. There's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place and bring it all to the table? There's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. He can see the weight you carry, the fears and hopes you're. But through the cross you've been forgiven. You're accepted as you are. So bring it all to the table. There's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your trials, all your worries and your burdens, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. Nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, the Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table.
You're listening to The Faith Experiment with Robbie Bergen, right across Australia, right here on Faith FM.
Welcome back to The Faith Experiment. I'm Robbie Bergen, and that was Zach Williams, To the Table. This is episode number 56. I'm calling this episode The Science of Focus. Stick around for the code word to get today's free giveaway, Your Journey Through the Bible in 365 Days. This is a little booklet that I have put together that is your guide to reading the Bible right through in 1 year. And I've done something very different in this little booklet. Most people, when they read the Bible in a year, or they attempt to try and do it, they try and read from Genesis to Revelation. And most people statistically will get to the book of Leviticus and they will end reading the Bible for the year. And so what this does, this little booklet, it will help you go through the Bible in a year, but it will break it up into themes. And so basically, each day of the week is a different theme of the Bible. So you have a day of the Gospels, a day of history, a day of poetry, a day of prophecy, a day of the law. And it breaks it up, makes it much, much easier to read the Bible through in 1 year. And so I have a little guide for you. If you get this, you can follow through. You can start it at any day in the year. You don't have to start on January 1st. You can just check day one, day two, day three. And the great thing is that I have put for each day the chapters that you need to read and what the summary of those chapters is going to be about. And it takes probably about 10 to 15 minutes each day to read the Bible through in 1 year. And most people really, really have never tried to accomplish it because they seem very intimidated by it. This is the faith experiment. We want to experiment with the Bible, and I want you to read through the Bible this year. And so you want to get your copy of Your Journey Through the Bible in 365 days absolutely for free. So stick around for the code word at the end of this episode, and I will get a copy of this little booklet out to you as soon as possible. Now, as we have been talking about, this is the Science of Focus on the Faith Experiment, episode 56. Before the break, we've talked about the pale blue dot. We've talked about looking out of your window seat on a plane at your house. And we have seen that if we have the opportunity to shift perspectives, then our focus can focus on the things that are actually important in life. If you can see your life sort of flashing before your life in the ER room, as I was sharing before the break, then you'll start to put things into perspective and therefore have better focus and make better choices and put effort into things that are more important and so on and so on. And then we started looking at, well, what are the tools available to us? Well, one of the tools is the reticular activating system, or the RAS, which is a system within the brain that basically acts as an executive assistant. It helps us focus on the things that we consider are important, and it helps us to ignore all the noise. For example, your body has a bunch of senses, about 5 senses. We've got touch, we've got taste, we've got smell, we've got hearing, and we've got vision. Constantly, your brain is being bombarded with information from all of those senses. So there's things in your vision, there's noises coming into your ears, there's sensations coming through your skin, whether it's the clothes you're wearing, the desk that you're touching, the hand that you're holding. There's the tastes galore of what you're eating. There's smells. You're being bombarded by sensory overload, essentially. And it's been said that if the reticular activating system didn't exist in our brains, we would literally burn our brains out with the amount of information that it's exposed to every nanosecond. And so what this reticular activating system does is it basically helps prioritize information and input to basically decide whether it's worthy of being alerted to the conscious part of the brain versus the subconscious of the brain. For example, could you imagine if you just focused on the feeling of your shirt on your arm, and that was just annoying you all day long because you could feel it? Well, that feeling is being sent to your brain constantly, but your reticular activating system is being taught to go, that's not important. That's just what we got to do. That's what we wear. Don't worry about the feeling. Ignore it. And so you can feel the difference between a feather, which is different, and your regular clothing. Anyway, that's the sort of point of the RSA and why we have it. So the question is, how can we use this to our advantage of seeing our lives in the right focus? How can we put these two things together? Well, we started looking at a couple of biblical teachings from these ancient manuscripts that help us sort of put things in perspective. We saw David looking at the perspective of, we are so small compared to the vastness of God and his handiwork. And then God speaking back to us going, hey, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. My ideals are higher than your ideals, and so on and so on. But let's look at some other biblical teachings in the ancient manuscripts to see what else there is for us regarding this idea of focus. And how can we use the reticular activating system to combine the power of these two principles, biblical text and the human biology? Well, let's look at a couple of texts. Here's the first one. This comes from Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. And we are told by the Apostle Paul, he says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue in, and if there is anything praiseworthy, this is what he says. He says, meditate on these things. So this is a very interesting biblical principle from these ancient manuscripts. The idea is that this is trying to train us into what is valued. So, for example, when you buy that red car, now all you're seeing when you drive around the roads in your local suburb in the shopping center car park is the red car, the same make, the same model, the same year. But previously, before you owned it, you never saw that car anywhere. What you did is you trained your brain subconsciously, but you trained it that this car is important to me. This is valuable to me. And now your RSA is working as an executive assistant and saying, hey, brain, there's another car that you consider to be valuable. There's another car that's considered to be valuable. But meanwhile, you're ignoring all the blues, you're ignoring all the whites, the greens, the blacks, the silvers, and so on and so on. You, by giving your brain a instruction on what is valuable to you, it's now helping you only focus on the things that you consider to be valuable. So if we are to train our RSA that this is the thing that is noble, this is a thing that is just, this is a thing that is pure, this is a thing that is lovely, this is a thing that has good report, this is a thing that has virtue, this is a thing that's praiseworthy, then guess what's going to happen? As the Apostle Paul said, he said, you'll meditate on these things, which means that your RSA is now going to go, hey, this is important to Master Brain. Pass it up, pass it up, pass it up. So now when you're scrolling through social media, you'll start to blur on the things that are not noble, the things that are not just, the things that are not pure, the things that are not lovely, the things that are not of good report. I think you get the idea, right? So here's another principle that the Apostle Paul uses in the book Colossians chapter 3 and verse 2. We're instructed there, it says, set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. And so again, same principle. We're being instructed to intentionally tell our RSA, we need to focus on the things that are above, the things that are good and noble and good report and all those sorts of things we mentioned before. And don't focus on the earthly things. Now, in the context, what Paul's talking about are the things that are they're distracting. It's like the dust compared to the jewel. Don't focus on the dust, focus on the jewel. It's that kind of principle. And the good news is that when you repeat this instruction, just verbally, it's been proven scientifically that if you verbalize what you consider to be important, your RSA will automatically start going, okay, this is important. Alert the master brain when I'm exposed to these things, whether they're good and lovely, virtue and pure and noble and so on and so on. Here's another point that you should take away from this. We need to be intentional on focusing on the things that are true. Now, there's a lot of things that are fake. There's a lot of things that are literally false. But focus on the things that are true. And by default, the RSA will pick up on this and will start to only bring to you the things that are true, the things that are noble, the things that are just, the things that are pure. Here's another principle of the RSA and the biblical teachings. The second one is to cultivate the mind of Christ. The Apostle Paul also writes this in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5. He says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. So the goal here is for our mind to be like the mind of Jesus Christ. Now, how is that going to happen? Well, if you focus on the things that are noble and just and pure and lovely and good report and virtue and praiseworthy, these are the things that are in the mind of Christ. And so Paul is telling us now that if we put our focus on having the mind of Christ, the RSA is going to pick up on this once again, the same way that you just bought a new t-shirt and now your RSA says that in t-shirt's important to us. And so now you're seeing that t-shirt everywhere you look. These verses are powerful reminders of the importance on focusing on things that are true. And by doing so, we're going to train our minds on focusing what's important. And this is going to avoid distractions and negative influences, because that's the opposite of what we're teaching the RSA to focus on. So here's a third principle. In the book of Hebrews, again, the Apostle Paul wrote this probably, chapter 12, verse 2, he says, looking unto Jesus. That's the same idea of focusing. Focus on Jesus. Put your perspective on Jesus. He says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, has sat down at the right hand of God on the throne. And so what this is teaching us, that we need to focus on Jesus. He's the author, he's the finisher of our faith. We follow where he leads. So here are some very simple principles biblically that if we start intentionally focusing on these things, our reticular activating system is going to pick up on that, and it's going to filter out the things that we don't consider to be important, which are the things that are not good, the things that are not pure, the things that are not uplifting or of good report. So these are some of the principles on bringing these two systems together to help us achieve a new perspective, a new focus as we start a new year. There's a famous text in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God. That means you're putting your perspective, your focus on seeking the kingdom of God. Again, this is training your RSA that these are the things that are important to us. Anything connected to God's kingdom, that's important to us. Anything connected to God's righteousness or his character, that's important to us. As you intentionally tell yourself, these are the things that I'm interested in, these are the things that I want to focus on, your RSA will start to filter out the things that don't support your goal and your perspective. Well, it's time to take a short break now. When we come back in our final segment, I have the giveaway code for you to claim your great free offer, Your Journey Through the Bible in 365 Days, a fantastic little booklet that I have put together to help you as a guide on what to read, when to read it, to help you journey through the biblical manuscripts in 365 days. You won't want to miss your free copy. Stick around right after this song. We've got Zach Williams and Dolly Parton with There Was Jesus. I'll be right back after this on The Faith Experiment.
If you have enjoyed this episode of The Faith Experiment, please help us get the word out by sharing our podcast with your friends and family. And don't forget to like us on Facebook.
Every time I try to make it on my, every time I try to stand, start to fall. And all those lonely roads that I traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. Well, there was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. For this man who needs amazing kindness, for forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. And I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. Well, there was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, I couldn't see it. There was Jesus on the mountain in the valleys.
There was Jesus
in the shadows of the alleys.
There was Jesus
in the fire and the floods.
There was Jesus,
always is and always was. No, I never walked alone. There was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
This is the Faith Experiment with Robbie Bergen. Right across Australia, right here on Faith FM. Listen live or listen later. Get the Faith FM app from your app store today.
Welcome back to the Faith Experiment. I'm Robbie Bergen, and that was Zach Williams with Dolly Parton. There was Jesus. This is episode 56, The Faith Experiment, and I'm calling this episode The Science of Focus. And before the break, we have explored a whole bunch of different things regarding perspective and focus. We've looked at that amazing picture, the pale blue dot from 6 billion kilometers away. We've talked about being in an aircraft at 37,000 feet, looking down at our own roof in our house, and helping us see that not everything is as it seems. Not everything is as important as it seems right here and right now. We've also explored the reticular activating system and how this system is our secret weapon, almost, on helping us train ourselves into what is important and what is not important. We looked at, just before the break, some of the biblical principles regarding where our focus should be, where our perspective should be. We should set our mind on things above. We should be thinking about the things that are noble and just and true and pure and of good report. We were told to look to Jesus. We were told to have the mind of Christ. You see, the great principle is that what you focus on becomes important to you. And what you consider to be important is the thing that you think about. And the thing that you think about defines who you are. Let's see it from the biblical perspective. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 7, it says, seek, that's focus, and you will find. What you put your focus on, you'll find it. Then we're told in Matthew chapter 6, verse 21, for where your treasure is, that's the thing you value, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also, that's your mind. So what you focus on becomes important to you. And then we're told that as he thinks in his heart, so is he. That's Proverbs 23, verse 7. As he thinks in his heart, so is he. That's his identity. And so the thing that we focus on becomes important. The thing that's important to us is what we think about. And the thing we think about defines our identity. So the question is, how do we focus on the things that are important? Well, Philippians 4:13 tells us what we can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So right there in that verse is your faith experiment for the year. If the text says you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you, you can shift your focus on the things that are pure, the things that are true, the things that are noble. You can have the mind of Christ. You can have the character of God as your number one pursuit, the kingdom of God, the righteousness of God. You can do it because the text says you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. So when we think about our experience, our touch, our sight, our sound, our taste, our smell, all of these things are subconsciously coming in through the reticular activating system. But if we tell it, this is what we value, this is what's important to us, it's going to help us to do exactly that, to change our focus. So here's a couple of very practical exercises you can do. It's been proven that if you literally sit down and write out what you want to focus on, your subconscious, your RSA, is actually learning as you are doing this. So as you sit down and take out a piece of paper and a pen or a keyboard on a computer or a thumbs on a phone and you write down, this is what I want to focus on. I want to focus on pure things, true things, righteous things, the character of God things, the mind of Christ things. You actually sit down and list out the things that you want to focus on. Your RSA is taking note of it in real time, and you will start to notice those things appearing more in your life. The same way that when you buy that red car, now you see that red car absolutely everywhere. The second thing you can do is sit down each and every day and recount the day in with a time with God. You know, some people call this meditation. The Bible uses the expression in Psalm 119, verse 97. It says, "How I love your law. It is my meditation all the day." We are told in Psalm 63 that my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips when I remember you on my bed. I meditate on you in the night watches. And so an exercise could be is that as you're laying in the bed, as you're starting to unwind and go to sleep, just recount everything that's happened that day with God, the things that are right, the things that are pure, the things that are noble, the mind of God, the character of God, the mind of Christ, and the kingdom of God. And this is going to help reinforce with the RSA, these are the things that I want to focus on in 2024. The next thing is very, very practical, is to set aside, say, a minute, 2 minutes each day, and thank God for what he has done that day. Not what he did yesterday, not what he did 10 years ago or 50 years ago. Make it a ritual that every day you sit down as an individual or as a family or as a couple and say, this is what I want to praise God for. This is what I want to thank God for. And you will start to find that the first couple of days is really hard to come up with something that you want to be thankful for. But as you go on with this exercise, your RSA kicks into automatic mode, and now it starts to see the multiple things to be thankful for each and every day. So, can you shift your perspective to really see what is important in your life? What is really worth your time in 2024? Well, you can. The Bible is giving you some promises, and promises are worthy of experimenting in the faith experiment. And so I challenge you this year, put these practical steps into your daily ritual and tell me what changes you notice taking place in your faith experiment. All right, now I mentioned at the top of the show that I have this great gift to give you. It is a little booklet that I've written called Your Journey Through the Bible in 365 Days. It's a little booklet that literally has a checkbox for 365 days, and each checkbox tells you what passage of the Bible to read, and it tells you what the theme of the day is, and it tells you a short summary of it. If you read through that every day, you will read the entire Bible in 365 days. And it takes about 10 to 15 minutes each day. It's very short. You can easily give up Facebook for 15 minutes and you'll be able to read the Bible in a year. And as a faith experimenter, you should absolutely, fundamentally have read through the Bible at least once in your faith experiment. And so this is my little gift to you to help you this year to make that a reality. If you say, Robbie, I'm only listening to this, a month in, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, 1 year into the faith experiment, what do I do? No problem. My system's not based on dates. It's based on sequence. So you can start any day you want. As long as you keep reading and checking off those marks, you will read the Bible through in 365 days. So to get today's free offer, you need to pick up your phone right now and you want to take out your messaging app and send a text message to the Faith Experiment. The number is 04-888-45311. That's 04-888-45311, and send the code word #FE56. That's #FE56. Send that through to 04-888-45311, and we will ask you for some details, and we will get this book out to you absolutely free. so you too can thrive in your faith experiment.
You have been listening to The Faith Experiment with Robbie Bergen, right across Australia, right here on Faith FM.